Further ado, and without further ado, I would like to introduce Jim Gallert and Lars Bjorn. Take it away, gentlemen.
Thank you, Ken. We are going to start with looking at Detroit from the perspective of Paradise Valley, which was, along with Black Bottom, the center of the Black community. Paradise Valley was located in this area that you can see on the map, basically east of Woodward Avenue, with Gratiot as a southern boundary line and going up to Verner Highway on the north. And then on the west, it would be Brush, and on the east, it's Hastings Street. Hastings was a very important street, and we're going to talk a lot about that as we go through our presentation. So jazz is, as you probably already know, a music that came out of the Black community within the generally overall white society. So it's an interactive thing between whites and Blacks. Jazz changes as race relations change between Blacks and whites. That's the one of the basic ideas of the book. The book is called Before Motown, and we wrote that several years ago, about 20 years ago now, and it's still available. So we want to start by going down Hastings Street, looking at what was happening on Hastings Street. There is a song that's been recorded by someone named Detroit Count. His birth name was Bob White. And he was a popular performer in Detroit in the 40s and 50s. And this piece is recorded in the late 40s. And he calls it the Hastings Street Opera. And we're going to play for you Hastings Street Opera Part 2. So, and there is a Part 1 and Part 2. And basically what he does, he gives you kind of a tour of Hastings Street in terms of its hangouts, bars and record shops, restaurants, and so on, with, of course, a lot of focus on the music. So we're going to play Hastings Street Opera Part 2. And you can, if you see the list of places he mentions, you can follow along, hopefully. Many of the records we play today are 78s. So, and they're a little scratchy originally. So don't expect hi-fi or modern sound. So let's hear Detroit Count.
One way out, never go in that joint. Leland Hastings. Leland Bar, that's the only brown town where the bartenders carry pistols. And when they serve you, they say, have you got any money? You say, yes. Will you please pay them? Oh, no! Leland Hastings, Mr. Rice's Fish House. You can smell that fish queen in Los Angeles, California, boy. All down the line. That's the only place in town where you can buy a steak sandwich and it'll taste like fish. You cook everything in Miss Rice's in the same breeze. A-Town. Brandon Hastings, filling station, gas, 25 cents a gallon. 90 cent tax. Mack and Hastings, silver dish, spill home. If you can't get a bite, go somewhere and snatch one. Across the street, Joe's Record Shop. He's got everybody in there except a T-bone steak. Down Hastings Street. Elliot. Then, Hastings Street Bar. That's the only place where the bar's gonna shoot everybody in there after 2 o'clock. sleeping hours till 5 o'clock in the morning, and please don't bother our rocks. Walker Hanson, People's Bob. Owned by Little Dave Open. Boy, that joint's a killer. That's the only joint where the customer drop over the bar and get 2 pistols and run everybody out of Detroit. Hanson Street Opera, on down the line. Wilkins! Freestyle bar to call a fire department to put the band on the bandstand. Alfred and Hastings, Kev Rosebud, better known as Brown's Bob. That's the only judge you can walk in on the Hastings Street side and run like hell coming back out on the Hastings Street side. Kev Calvin, old folks home. That's the only bar in town where they serve drinks free to everybody that's 102 years old accompanied by their mother and father. Down Hastings Street. Blue Harbor, that's the only joint you walk in, you have to duck and crawl on your knees to buy yourself a bottle of beer. Arcade Theater, Border Highway, Big Top Hamburger Stand. All down now, short run coming, Fort Reeves Pocket. Fort Reeves Music Bar, boy, anything you have there. That's the only bar in town that when you go in to buy yourself a drink, hold on to your pocketbook very tight. One of your favorites yourself. So that's all. That's all of Hastings Street Opera.
Wow, that was cool. I don't know how many operas you've been to, but this is a very unusual opera. Okay, so let's stop this one. We don't want to hear this yet. Anyway, he's quite an entertainer. I hope you could understand some of the stuff he said. It's not always easy, given the technology and so on, and the distance in time. We are going to go on and take a look at a few more slides. Here are some slides of Paradise Theater, which became a number one spot for jazz and blues in the 40s into the early 50s. It started out as Orchestra Hall, and then it was converted to a place that basically attracted black audiences and black artists. There were whites in the audience, but there were very few. Here is a view of the Paradise from the outside. So it was a very fancy place. You've been to Orchestra Hall, I assume, and you know what a wonderful set of acoustics they have there. It's really spectacular. In the 40s, you could go there to hear big bands, as you can see from this advertisement. You could hear Duke Ellington and his orchestra, and then the Orioles, who are singers, as well as Peck and Peck, and Al Hibbler, who was another singer. And then they would also sometimes show movies. So you got movies, entertainers, and of course, a wonderful band. And the band would stay for at least a week. So it was really spectacular. And entrance was very cheap. It was very, very doable for most people. So a lot of people were exposed to live jazz of the highest quality at the Paradise Theater, which is why Orchestra Hall now has its jazz series named Paradise Theater Series. Okay.
Okay, thanks, Lars. Now we're moving up into the first honest-to-God rhythm and blues bands in Detroit. Lars and I call these bands jump bands, because they're like an urbanized form of blues, and they have a sort of a raw urgency. It's nothing at all like what rhythm and blues you hear today sounds like. This was much more rough and ready style that really had people moving. People love to dance to R&B. Detroit had three main bands during the 1940s. The first, which is up here now on the screen, is led by pianist T.J. Fowler. You can see he's at the microphone right next to the owner of Lee's club sensation. Uziel Sensation Lee, he was called. And right next to on the other side of T.J. Feller, you see the Queen of Detroit Blues, Alberta Adams, who only died a few years ago. And I'm sorry, that's not, T.J.'s over way on the end. He's not at the microphone. My apologies for that. T.J. Feller was an interesting guy. He was one of these guys that, a can-do kind of a guy. He had a lot of initiative. He owned a lawn care service. He taught courses at different high schools around Detroit on Black music history in Detroit. He also was a recording engineer and worked part-time when they were just getting started for Motown Records. And he would help set up the equipment and everything for them. He was a very knowledgeable guy. And he was a hell of a blues and boogie-woogie pianist too. This is on the cover of Before Motown. It's a picture of the King Porter Orchestra at Spore Trees Music Bar, and it was taken in March of 1948. And if you're familiar with blues and boogie-woogie or black music in general, you see Big Joe Turner there, the big guy in the back, who's got his hand on King Porter's shoulder. And then Billy Mitchell, who grew to be one of the great modern tenor saxophonists, is in front of Big Joe. And again, far over on the left of the photograph is Alberta Adams. And she was very popular around Detroit, and she sang with all sorts of bands. And for this week at Livonia, at King Porter's Orchestra at the Spore Trees Music Bar, Big Joe Turner was brought in from Kansas City to guest with King Porter's Orchestra. Fortunately, these bands that I'm talking about now, King Porter's Band and T.J. Fowler, also recorded. So you can, if you can hunt them down and find some recordings that they did. Now we come to the one, probably the best one of all, Todd Rhodes Orchestra. Todd Rhodes had been in Detroit since 1927. He came here with a group that was known as McKinney's Cincos, which evolved into McKinney's Cotton Pickers. And Todd was a very good pianist, strongly influenced by James P. Johnson. And he stayed here after the Cotton Pickers went bust during the early 1930s and were reduced to just playing the occasional gig every several months. He managed to stick around and got gigs with Cecil Lee's orchestra. And in the early 40s, he started his own bands. He started hosting quartets and quintets. By 1945, he was leading a 5 or 6 piece combination around town, and he had latched on to what, as I said earlier, jump and jive music that Lars and I call jump music. You can see that this band has got a 1, 2, 3, 4 piece horn section, bass, drums, and Todd Rhodes on piano. And this, these bands were powered by the piano, and they had to have a strong drummer and bassist too. And you'd occasionally have a singer with them. Now this photograph was taken at Lee's Sensation Lounge, once again, in 1947. The reason Todd Rhodes got to make recordings is because one of the guys that owned a record label in Detroit, and there weren't many record labels, when the band got up to play one tune, they went outside and walked up and down the street and then back into the club. And most of the club people, the customers, got up and followed them. And that's what convinced the record guy to record them, that they had something special going for them. Anyway, we'll hear a little bit of a song called Your Daddy's Doggin' Around that has a beautiful tenor saxophone solo by Charles Lefty Edwards.
What did you see?
I saw him all in her town.
What did you see?
I saw him kiss her goodnight.
So you finally found your daddy's dogging around. What did you hear?
Just what everyone heard.
Yeah, if we had more time, we could play more music for you. But that's a great tune. That was Connie Allen, who was kind of a hired vocalist from around town. She stayed in Detroit. She died here in 1991. So she had a fairly long life, but she dropped out of the R&B business, it seems, in the 60s, the 1960s. Again, that recording is available too, if you're so inclined. And right now we're going to go from listening to bands and pictures of bands to a map here that we have. Most of the map is in before Motown, Detroit jazz spots in the 40s and 50s. And you can see there's a quite a selection. You can see on the map that you've got Detroit River, Belle Isle, Grand River, Gratiot, and Woodward Avenue is in the center. So you can see that the clubs were sprinkled heavily around the immediate downtown area, and a few of them out on Gratiot and also on Grand River. One that Lars is going to be talking about is the Bluebird Club, the Bluebird Bar. And another one that's up here, a couple that aren't on the map, the World Stage, the West End Hotel, and also the Rouge Lounge in River Rouge, just south of Detroit. So anyway, I'd like to turn it over to Lars to talk about some bebop and beyond.
Yeah. The Bluebird Inn became a hangout for musicians in the late 40s. They had always had music there starting in the 30s, but what's unusual is that they brought in modern jazz in the late 40s, and it became really a hangout for this generation of beboppers, which was kind of the new generation during World War II. And this becomes kind of a second generation of beboppers, really. And you can see that when you look at migration from Detroit to New York City, which of course is and has always been the center of jazz in the country, particularly modern jazz. Now, what made the house band unique was the talent in the band. The musical leader was a trumpeter cornetist named Thad Jones. The formal leader was a tenor player, Billy Mitchell. They had a wonderful piano player for many years, Terry Pollard. The bassist was Beans Richardson, and the drummer was Elvin Jones, who later becomes really famous as John Coltrane's drummer. But they met in Detroit and made, they knew each other by the time that Elvin joined the John Coltrane band. So the Bluebird was really a hangout. So what you have there is you had a house band, and then you would have a lot of people who just show up and sit in, which of course is a jazz tradition that musicians walk around to different clubs and come in and sit in. And people who are new to jazz have a hard time understanding that. How can they know what to play? Well, you know, there are a lot of standard, there's a lot of songs in the standard repertoire. And if you're a jazz musician, you know that standard repertoire. So it's easy to fit in, relatively easy, once you have those tunes down and once you have the requisite skills. Okay. So let's look at the next slide about the Bluebird.
What's up, buddy?
Oh, that,
the house
band. That is the one slide we have. Okay. I'm going to play a piece by the Bluebird house band when they got together a few years later. They were all in New York City, and they got together and played on a number of recordings. And here is a band that comes out of the house band. It's called A Little Juicy. Let's Okay. So that, sorry, I had to interrupt Thad Jones in the middle of his solo, but we don't have time to listen to the whole thing. You can find this on YouTube, so you can enjoy the whole album. That's called A Little Juicy. It's a wonderful, wonderful album. Thad Jones, as I said, was the musical leader. He went on to become one of the most important members of the Count Basie Big Band. He arranged for the band, and of course he played trumpet or cornet in the band as well. So, and then he lives out his last years in Europe and had his own big band in Copenhagen, Denmark. So he is really one of the big stars in modern jazz. Before he went to Denmark, he had a big band at the Village Vanguard as well in New York City. So Thad Jones is a spectacular musician, was a spectacular musician. Okay, we're going to move on. What's our next slide?
Bakers.
Bakers, yes. The most famous jazz club in Detroit, of course, is Baker's Keyboard Lounge. People know that very well. And we have several shots from the Baker's, which of course is still open and pretty much unaltered. It's a fabulous place to visit, not only for the music, but for its beautiful interior. It was redecorated in the early 50s, and it's a wonderful interior. You really feel you're someplace when you go there. One person who was really important in Detroit jazz life, we mentioned earlier, and that's the piano player, Terry Pollard. And she played for many years with a vibraphonist from New York named Terry Gibbs. And as you can see in these ads, that was emphasized in the advertising for Terry Gibbs Band, Detroit's own Terry Pollard. She then joins the Yusuf Lateef Quartet. Yusuf Lateef has a very long career in Detroit and New York. He starts out in Detroit and then leaves in the late 40s for New York to join the Dizzy Gillespie Big Band. When he comes back to Detroit, he forms his own group. And for many years, he had a gig at Klein's Show Bar on 12th Street. This is a picture of the quintet with Terry Pollard on piano, Frank Morelli on baritone, and Yusuf playing flute on this one. He is a multi-instrumentalist. He plays flute and tenor sax. That was a fabulous band. And luckily, Yusuf Lateef recorded his groups. So we can follow the history of the Yusuf Lateef small groups on records. And what it was quite amazing how they accomplished that. They play regular gigs in Detroit, and then late at night, they would drive to New York and stay overnight and the next day for recording sessions. And they did this several times, but they were young and extremely energetic. And of course, very creative artists. So you can follow Yusuf Lateef in his recordings. We're going to play one piece by Yusuf Lateef called 25 Minute Blues. Thank you. Sorry, we have to cut it there. We only have so much time. But you can probably tell what a great blues player Yusuf Lateef was. And lo and behold, he had a background in blues bands. He played with a lot of the local bands. And of course, living in Detroit, he heard it blues all the time. So that's one of the major things that define his career, at least this part of his career. He had a long career after he left Detroit. And we can talk about that some other time. But he is one of the major players coming out of Detroit. Let's say a few words about Detroit blues. Detroit blues was something that centered around a number of artists. The single most famous Detroit blues artist is no doubt John Lee Hooker, who came from Clarksville, Mississippi, up to Detroit in the 1940s, and he worked at Ford Motor Company, among other places. Blues musicians, like other musicians, particularly African-Americans, do not make a lot of money. So it is very common for them to have well-paying industrial jobs for part of their careers. And it's amazing how they made it, how they could work on the assembly line and play in clubs at night. I remember Yusuf Lateef talking about that because he also worked on the assembly line at Chrysler. Other blues artists were Eddie Burns, Washboard Willie, and then Calvin Frazier. And we're going to play a piece by Calvin Frazier. Let's see, where is that?
Lily May.
Lily May, yes. We were going to play Frazier, but we decided to put in somebody a little less known. So we have Willie May. Where is
Lily May?
Where is Willie May? Willie May, where are you? She has run away.
Is there no Lily May?
No.
Okay.
So let's move
gospel
over.
Then.
Let's move over to the gospel. Yes. So let's do the gospel. As everybody knows, I'm sure, is that African American music is multifaceted. One important part of it is the gospel. And so jazz comes out of blues and gospel and a number of other musics it interacts with before it becomes full-fledged jazz. Detroit had a number of great gospel artists. You can see some of them here. For example, the Flying Clouds Quartet of Detroit. And we can hear them sing here, "When They Ring the Golden Bells." So let's listen to that.
There's a land beyond the river.
So sorry to cut that off, but we are short on time. You can hear, of course, a number of things that influence jazz musicians in gospel. the call and response is one of the most important ones, where you have someone stating a theme and then you have a response, often by a larger group. And that can get very exciting. One thing that Detroit did not have very much of compared to big cities like New York or Chicago is record labels. There were a few, but they were so-called independents. They didn't last very long. They didn't make much money, but they are historically very important. The most well-known one of them is Sensation Records, which recorded Todd Rhodes. And then we have Fortune Records and several other small labels, including Paradise. So we have some of those discs shown here. They came out in, they started operating in the late 40s and lasted relatively briefly, about 3 or 4 years typically, if they did well. Fortune Records lasted longer than others. Many of these labels used the United Sound Systems studios on Second Avenue, which is still standing. That was really the number one recording studio in Detroit. Here's Fortune Records, and you can tell from the looks of it that it was not a very, very profitable record label. But they were on Second Avenue, and they were run, it was a family-owned business run by Jack and Devorah Brown, who are pictured here. They had a house band led by Joe Weaver and his Blue Notes, and that was a very important band. It had a guitar player named Johnny Bassett, who became, in his mature years, a major Detroit blues performer.
Yeah, other groups that recorded for Fortune, and Fortune, as Lars said, was around during the time that Motown music was around. And in fact, they had their biggest selling records in the early 1960s when Motown was really starting to gain traction and take off. But what they didn't have was very good distribution. In fact, they could have made, if they'd really taken care of business, they could have made a lot of money. Fortune Records could have. And the problem was getting the records distributed around the country. You had to have a network of distributors set up, people that you could trust that would pay you promptly and would sell your recordings and get your artists some exposure. One group that they did have that was very good and had one of their best-selling recordings was Nolan Strong and the Diablos. And these were all high school kids from Central High School, which was located just across the street from Fortune Records at the time, just before Fortune moved down further downtown. And you can see the Diablos, they had the nice slick look going on with the matching plaid jackets and stuff, and they all looked sharp and they could sing, especially Nolan Strong, who was the lead singer. And he really powers Mind Over Matter. This was written by Janice or Devorah Brown, one of the owners of Fortune Recordings, and it would have sold a lot more than it did, but at least Nolan Strong made a little money off of it. So let's listen to a bit of Mind Over Matter by Nolan Strong and the Diablos.
If I can find it.
Remember, Lars, it was on YouTube, I think?
Yeah. Yeah, I'll get it. Hold on a second.
Okay. Nolan Strong had some artistic differences with the Browns, and he ended up leaving the label not long after Mind Over Matter was recorded. By this time, he had been drafted. He was in the Army for 2 years. When he came out, he had problems, and he ended up drinking a little bit too much. But Devorah Brown said that he had such beautiful eyes and that she could never, she said she thought of him as a son. She could never kick him out or anything, but he ended up leaving at some point, and he didn't have a very good career after Fortune Records, unfortunately. He was a massive talent, though.
Well, here you can hear him. Mind over matter. That was recorded in 1962.
Yeah, thanks, Lars. Anyway, they were one of the more popular groups at Fortune Records. Fortune Records actually lasted, I think it was about 12 years until they finally were overrun by Motown. But what the Fortune Records had that Motown didn't have was an amazing variety of music that they recorded. They recorded hillbilly music. They recorded country and Western music. They recorded some fantastic jazz by a very obscure pianist named Willie Anderson. So they took all these things. Jack Brown had big ears and he liked music. So if it sounded good to him, they would make a recording of it and sign the artist to a contract, and maybe everyone would make a little money and go away happy. Didn't usually happen, unfortunately. And here's another band, and this guy had the best-selling record that Fortune Records ever recorded. Oh no, not him, he didn't. This is Andre Williams. He had the strangest recordings, and this is a group that really exemplified that sort of uncontrolled wildness that you pick up in various Detroit rock and roll groups, like Iggy Stooge and the MC5. Andre Williams was a little earlier. He was in the 1950s, and he came up with a song that was continued to sell called Bacon Fat. And it was more, sort of an early rap thing, as you'll hear. So let's listen to a little bit of Bacon Fat.
All my friends was glad to see me. Seen some down by the railroad track. Seen some cotton pickers with their sacks on their backs. They say, man, glad to see you back. We got a new dance they call Bacon Fat. It goes. Yourself, then you go. Oh, but the chicken was never like this. Yeah. Oh, I feel like I'm on a holler, but the town's too small. And messy. And then I went down to see my local DJ. His name is Kane, he lived down Tennessee way. I said, hey man, what's this new kind of jump? Well, you wind up twice and then you end up with a bump. He said, dig that in, this is a natural fact. It's a sweep in the south. Bacon fat, you go.
Jesus, Lars.
Entertain the people, youngin. Oh, help you.
Lars.
Yeah.
Stop.
Oh, now play it good. Now play it good.
Hey, Lars.
Yeah.
I think Jim wants you to stop.
I know. I can't stop it.
Andre Williams continued to play in Detroit. He was born in Chicago, but he spent quite a bit of time in Detroit, and he played clubs around town, and I saw him a couple times, and he was a real character. He did funny little dances, had all kinds of little movements and everything, and had his voice was still in pretty good shape. Now we come to a man that had the last good selling recording for Fortune Records. That's Nathaniel Mayer, who had a recording in 1964 of Village of Love. Come to the Village of Love. Nathaniel was actually born here in Detroit, and he had a couple of lives in show business. The first one, when he made that recording, he was around 18 years old. And then he gets out of the recording business for quite a while, and he comes back around when he's around 60 years old. And he had, he was like a precursor to James Brown. He had all sorts of explosive movements and raspy voices and things. He was definitely a Detroit artist. And fortunately, the Devorah and Jack Brown recorded him. Nathaniel Mayer, and his stuff is readily available, as is Andre Williams. Now we start rounding up musicians who are going to be important to Motown recordings. This is at a club called the Club Sudan in 1946. You can see, if you're familiar with jazz, Milt Jackson on vibes. On piano is Phil Hill. Elvin Jackson, Milt's younger brother, on bass. And on guitar, Joe Messina, who played in the Motown studios for years. Here we have a picture of Todd Rhodes' band at the Flame Show Bar. And William Benny Benjamin is highlighted. And it was Benny Benjamin that became the first drummer over at Motown Recordings. And he held that chair down for quite a while. But anyway, that was an important group, and he was an important guy. Now we come up to John R., the Street of Music. It was called that by the Negro Press in Detroit. And this is a time when John R. was seeing an eruption of clubs all up and down. And he had like nearly a dozen clubs that played all types of music. You can see that Hastings Street is still popular and still has a lot of clubs, but the newer clubs, we're moving over to John R. Street. The Frame, the Frolic, the Chesterfield, the Parrots, all these things were over on John R. Street. This is a quote taken from Berry Gordy's book, To Be Loved. I'll just briefly read it out to you. This is a picture of him and Billie Holiday taken at the Flame. All the beautiful people came to life at night. The sharpest dressed black and white people I had ever seen. John R. Street was jumping with clubs like Sonny Wilson's Garfield Lounge, the Chesterfield Lounge, and nearby the Frolic Show Bar. that where you'd usually find me was down the street on the corner of John R. and Canfield at the most popular ball, the Flame Show Bar. And on the right side, you see an ad for Billie Holiday, who was the first jazz singer to appear there, which is fitting. Here are some ads for groups that worked at the Flame Show Bar between 1951 and 1959. The Flame was the primary outlet for national Black entertainers. So you had, you can look on the different ads and see all these names, many of which probably don't mean much to you. Joe Turner, however, was a king of the blues. He came in. A well-known Black actor, Mantan Moreland, was in. Gatemouth Brown. Larry Steele's Smart Affairs of 1958. Larry Steele led this little affair, the Smart Affair, from 1946 to 1972. And they would travel all around the country with interpretive dancing. They would have vocal groups, the Wanderers. They had the Fouché Dancers, was a small group of men or female impersonators dancing. A comic and imitator named Sir Lionel Beckles. Then on the far right, you see the Tune Weavers. They were kind of a folk singing group. They were like a one-hit wonder. But the Flame went on, and it was wonderful. It finally collapsed in 1963, not literally, but it was taken over in 1963. What happened was Berry Gordy worked at the Flame Show Bar. His sisters had the photo concession. And Berry Gordy would take the negative, run downstairs, develop it, put it in one of those little cards, and bring it back up to his sisters. And they would give it to the customer and receive payment for it. Berry got to know all the musicians. He got to know Maurice King, who was a fantastic band leader and musician and arranger. And he got to know Jackie Wilson. He got to know all these guys that would come in and either sing or audition or perform with a band. And Berry Gordy was laying out his plan, his grand plan. And he would take all these people, these wonderful people he met, and they would follow him over to Motown when he decided to make his move, because he didn't want to go and hear his parents' music. He wanted to hear his own music, which was Motown. So when the Flame Show Bar basically went out of business in 1963, Berry had taken a lot of these people, the musicians, and started something really cooking over at Motown Records. This is a picture we got too late for our book, unfortunately. It's the outside of the Flame Show Bar, which is it's a great shot. That's the hot dog salesman, guy that was always on the corner there. There's a beautiful parking structure there now. It's so much better than having a fabulous nightclub. This is the interior of the Flame Show Bar. You can see, this is why in Detroit, this is what a show bar was. You can see that the band stage is on the top, on the same level as the bar. So you'd be sitting there on stools and stuff, and you could kind of look up to see what was happening on stage. This is a picture of the house band, Maurice King and the Wolverines. And Maurice, as we said earlier, took up a position at Motown Recordings, at Motown Records, and so did Beans Bowles. He's the baritone player. He worked with, he was a road manager for Stevie Wonder. And here we see the owner of the Flame Show Bar, Morris Wasserman. And that's one of those little photo cards I was just telling you about. And then below that, we see two little drink mixers, swizzle sticks, they used to call them, that you could mix your drink, whatever libation was your preference. Here's a casual shot at the Flame Show Bar sometime during the 1950s. Morris Wasserman is the owner, Al Green was the manager, and he was associated with the mob back then, and he would always pounce on any new talent that he liked and get them into a personal management contract that benefited Al Green more than the performer. Ziggy Johnson, the great Ziggy Johnson, was a fantastic choreographer. And we see Todd Rhodes here on the far right, and the others, I'm not sure of their identity. This is another picture at the Flame, and you can see Louis Jordan, the great Louis Jordan, Albert Adams next to him, and Louis's wife, Fleecy Moore, was next to Louis. And Fleecy is the wife that cut Louis with a knife over disputes on royalties over a composition. Show business was dangerous sometimes. Famous Flame alumni. We've got Johnny Ray, who did Cry on the Little Cloud That Cried. Maurice Kane thought of him as a son. Here's a picture of Laverne Baker, who also got a lot of her start. She was from Chicago, but she got her early breaks here in Detroit. And there's Della Reese, who went on to have her own radio TV show. Mr. Excitement, Jackie Wilson, he got his start at the Flame, as did Little Willie John. And we encourage you to read the book that our friend and colleague Susan Whitehall wrote and published, biography of Little Willie John. It's really good. And this was one of the most famous groups that would play there. The Jewel Box Review, it was called. They were all female impersonators. And they would all try and sing like the woman that they dressed up as. But they were really popular, and the musicians always got a big kick out of them. They said they were a lot of fun to work with. Here's another bona fide show bar, the Frolic Show Bar, which is just across the street from the Flame. And you can see the bandstand is at the same, is on the same level as the stage and the bar. So again, when you were sitting at the bar, you could look up and see all the action going on. So that's the photo card there. These are some ads for the Frolic Show Bar. There were two locations. One was on John Lodge Service Drive, and the other was on 4450 John R. So you can see they featured singers like the Four Tops, and this is where they really got their start, the Four Tops, before they were over at Motown. Terry Pollard with Sonny Stitt, Louis Armstrong and his All-Stars coming in 1947. Here we come to a bigger montage of the Four Tops, and we're going to try and play maybe a minute or so of a song that they did with close harmony called Kiss Me Baby. Yeah, now, if no one told you that was the Four Toms, you'd never think it was them, would you? It's a far cry from Bernadette and all the other beautiful things they recorded for Motown. There you have it. This is two Motown bands that were actually working bands around town. The first was led by Joseph E. Hunter, And Joe Hunter was out of Tennessee. He was a really fine pianist. He had a band put together with, there's Benny Benjamin on drums, Jamie Jamerson on electric bass, amplified bass, Larry Veeder on guitar. And then the Earl Van Dyke Band, there's Earl playing the organ. I can't remember the guitar player's name, but that was the first bands that were actually working Motown Records bands that accompanied artists out on the road. What we see here is a wonderful musician that Lars and I both knew fairly well, George Benson, who started off playing alto, switched over to tenor. He was a real bar walker in the 1940s. He was in one of the high energy, high horsepower, high octane rhythm and blues bands, a jump blues band. And he was the last band at the Flame Show Bar, and this is in 1961. You've got on organ Earl Van Dyke, another pick of Earl Van Dyke, who was a mainstay over at Motown Records. And then on drums, you have Big Mike Lawton. What we're trying to show you tonight here was that all these different musicians and different styles of music, Detroit has so much music, so many different genres of music that they don't exist in little tiny cells or cubicles or anything. It's all thrown together. It's like a pastiche. And musicians listen with their ears, and Detroit musicians are not afraid to absorb music or something from somebody else, which is why we have such a fantastic spread of music around town. This is the first great girl singer with Motown, Mary Wells. And we're going to see if we have a few notes to end on of You Lost the Sweetest Boy, with Earl Van Dyke is on the piano with this. And you can hear the fusion. You can hear some blues, gospel, rock and roll, everything thrown into this. Are we good, Lars?
Yeah, it's coming.
Okay. We hope you enjoyed our little performance. If you have any questions, we've got a little bit of time, and I'm sure Ken would be happy to show you how to write them up and send them in to us. But anyway, thank you very much for your time and your attention on behalf of myself and Lars Bjorn.
Well, I want to thank everybody too for participating. I do have one question to ask you, gentlemen, if that's okay. Are you aware that any of the venues that we discussed tonight are still open under their same name? Are there any of them? Do you know?
Bakers.
Oh, Bakers, I know, is there. It's Pass It Up,
yeah,
a lot.
Bakers.
That's it.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's really interesting. I wanted to show you guys my Fortune Records t-shirt.
That's cool.
And I wanted to let our participants know that, well, first of all, that we do have Jim and Lars' book, Before Motown, A History of Jazz in Detroit. So please come to the library and get your copy. It's a great book and a great read. If you enjoyed tonight's presentation, I think you'll enjoy the book even more. I also want to remind everybody that in November, I have my personal friend, Mike Hurt, coming to the Civic Center Library, and he is going to discuss the book that he co-authored called Mind Over Matter. And it's actually named after the Diablos disc that Jim and Lars discussed tonight. The book is called Mind Over Matter, The Myths and Mysteries of Detroit's Fortune Records. And our speaker for that is going to be Michael Hurt, who co-authored the book. And that's going to be, I believe that is November 17th. We have it scheduled for right now. So you might be, if you found this interesting, you'll probably find the Mind Over Matter presentation interesting as well. So once again, I want to thank everybody for participating in this. Jim and Lars, you did a fantastic job. That was fascinating content. I will be sending each of you an email to the last email address that I sent something to today. I'll be sending you both an email tomorrow. So just wanted to remind you to take a look at your email if you get a chance tomorrow. And thanks again.
Thank you.
Hope to see you guys sometime
soon. Thank you very much.
Take care now, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye now.